We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the laws, we enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan liberty for all. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is June 14th, 2016, and I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, and you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com into the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, SoundCloud, and the next day on Stitcher. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom. Exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we are happy to hear from you. And you can reach us via phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. It's all one word. And just send a contact request with your name and what you want to talk about. And check us out at Nonpartisan Liberty for All, which has all that information and more, including original blogs and articles, as well as archives and other things. So I usually don't like talking about a story that the government media has been covering 24/7 for days. It's now Tuesday. It had happened, Saturday night. I'm, of course, referring to the Orlando shooting. But there's, when it comes to a story that can and probably will affect everybody in a negative way when it comes to freedom, it's not something that I can ignore, especially with all the bullshit that I'm hearing. I mean, and how much can you talk about in 3 days straight? I mean, this is wall-to-wall coverage, and I knew that. I just wanted to even check. So, like, Sunday, I think it was Sunday evening, I was thinking that I'm like, there's no way that they didn't cancel their normal shows and they're not covering this on CNN. And of course, what do you know? You turn on CNN and they're covering it. And it was the same thing with the Boston bombing, which that I actually watched. And I'm glad I did, because there's so many things I know about that, that they kept changing their story and how much bullshit it is, which it seems to be the case in some of this. This is just fucked up from beginning to end. And it's just a lot of things that do not make sense that I haven't seen anybody question, except on independent media. The and we'll get into the specifics, but everything that they say happened. Now, first of all, I don't believe anything I hear from government media. Now, I went through, I don't know how many articles, a bunch of YouTube videos, which were essentially news. I mean, it was Orlando Sentinel on YouTube, which is the newspaper over there. So they were covering it. I mean, what I'm saying is it was essentially what you'd see on TV cut up and put on YouTube. So I watched a lot of YouTube videos that were videos that came from government media. I didn't watch a lot of YouTube videos that came from independent media. Unfortunately, I did watch some Stephon Molyneux stuff where he pretty much takes their story for what it is. However, he did have somebody on who said the exact same thing I said. Not that he got it from me, you know, obviously, but he was thinking the same thing I was thinking. And that has to do with the amount of people killed in such a way with one person, one shooter under the circumstances. It's, as somebody, I'm not an expert on guns. I have an AR-15. I've shot an AR-15. I'm pretty familiar with, you know, I can take one apart and clean it and all that. I'm not an expert. I'm not a great shot, good enough. But in a situation like that, most of the shots, of course, would have been pretty close. But essentially what it sounds like happened to kill that many people and hit that many people, because you got to remember the amount of people injured. It sounds like fucking an assassin. Or I was just watching the movie with Denzel Washington where, you know, he's an older guy, because it's a pretty recent movie, and he used to be, you know, like a trained killer or a trained assassin or something like that. The Equalizer, which was actually a pretty good movie, where he, you know, just takes out five guys at once. I mean, it seems like you'd have to be that type of guy or have that type of training to be able to do this. And someone who was on Stephon Molyneux's show had kind of pointed that out, that how are you carrying that many rounds? And, you know, it's heavy. What about this guy, the shape of this guy as well? And I know that, you know, I have enough of a background, meaning, you know, I was a membership of a target range. I didn't renew it this year because I couldn't afford it, but I will next year. But I know enough about guns. I'm not an expert, but I'd say on a 1 to 10, maybe I'm like a 6 or something. I mean, compared to the majority of people, because a lot of people don't know shit. So compared to your average person, I mean, I know a lot, but compared to your, you know, gun expert, I don't know anything. But, you know, I know enough. And I have a pretty good AR-15. It's piston operated. It was pretty expensive. And because some of those will actually melt, I watched a show. There used to be, well, not used to be, they're still on, but it was like a reality show about a gun store, and there is this tool you can buy where you can turn an AR-15, a semi-automatic, into an automatic. Now, for those who don't know, and I'm sure a lot of the listeners know this, but for those who don't, the difference between semi-automatic and automatic is, semi-automatic, you got to keep pulling the trigger. Every time you pull the trigger, a bullet comes out, automatic, you pull the trigger back and bullets just keep coming out. Now, being that he bought the guns a couple days before, there's no way he had an automatic, because you can get an automatic, but it's pretty hard. You can't just walk into a gun store and buy an automatic. You have to have a special license, and it has to go through the federal government. And because I know this because at a gun show, I knew somebody who was buying an automatic, and I was talking to him, and he was telling me all about what he had to go through to get a license to get an automatic. And of course, you know, everything has to be clean. And this guy who was questioned by the FBI and even put on their watch list twice, there's no way that they would approve him for an automatic. From what I understand, a couple days before, he just went into the store and bought a couple guns, one being an AR-15, and he had a handgun. And the funny thing about, people make this big deal about AR-15s and they want to ban them. And, you know, AK-47s aren't much different, and there's a lot of guns. But the thing about the AR-15 is, when they did the ban in 1994, and there's no such thing as an assault rifle, it's a made-up word by people who don't know anything about guns. It's a legal term, and that constantly changes because it's based on, well, if the gun has this and it has a grip and it has, it's like stupid shit. Because basically on this same show, what they showed was, and I got to get back to what I was saying about the converting it, but they took a gun and an AR-15 and another rifle and essentially made the same thing. It just didn't look scary. It's just what it looks like the grip and this and that. But you can, the rifle that they had made was just as powerful, had just as many rounds, and essentially the same thing as an AR-15. It just didn't have all of the things that you look at on an AR-15 that makes it look scary. It's ignorant people just being ignorant. But first of all, I was talking about this thing that I guess converted it into a automatic, and the AR-15 they had was so shitty, you know, it was just a cheap AR-15, that it started melting the fucking gun. If you've ever seen the AR-15 with, it's like plastic, the plastic, I don't know the name of the piece. Actually, I do. I can't think of it, though. It's really the barrel, but it's not called the barrel on AR-15. They call it something else. I can't think of the name of it. I'm sorry. But people probably know what I'm talking about. Anyway, there's the ones that have like a lot of holes in it, like the piston based ones. And then there's like the gas based ones that are, you know, plastic, that are shitty. Anyway, that's what they had. And it fucking melted it, because it was just firing so fast, the heat. It got so hot that it started to melt it. So you have, I mean, someone had brought up, and people say all this ignorant shit when something like this happens, but you have an AK-47, which the bullets from an AK-47... Now, there's all these things that factor into it, like velocity, and that has to do with the type of bullets you buy, and if you're shooting hollow points or full metal jackets and all that stuff, and I'm far from an expert on any of that. But AR-15 bullets are bigger. Well, we'll try to describe it in an easy way. So, AK-47 bullets are bigger. They're 7.62 times 36 millimeter, where AR-15 bullets are 5.56 or 2.23. They're small. AR-15 bullets are pointy and small. They're really, they're called 2.23 for a reason. So if you look at a, and I have, because I have both the bullets. If you look at a AK-47 bullet right next to an AR-15 bullet, it's a lot, the AK-47 bullet is a lot bigger. So this whole, well, we'll ban AR-15s. Well, then people will use AK-47s, or they'll use the rifles that just don't look scary, but are still going to cause the same damage or more, like 308 rifles, I think would cause even more damage than an AR-15. I mean, AR-15s, I think, are more popular, and the Army essentially uses AR-15s or a version of them. I mean, they have automatics because of more than just, you know, the damage that they're able to do, but that they're light, whereas carrying around an AK-47, it's heavier, although supposedly AK-47s are a lot more durable as far as all this shit can happen to them, and they'll still last. But just because it's an AR-15, it doesn't mean it's the most powerful or the most dangerous gun or anything like that. And there's people who don't know anything about guns that probably think that. So they'll say, oh, ban the AR-15. Now, something I was thinking of this morning, and we ain't even gotten to what happened and how one person can, you know, get off at least 103 shots minimum. And they obviously got off a lot more than that, because that would be one shot for every person hit. But they sell most handguns now, unless you're in a Nazi state like New York or Massachusetts or one of those, they come with magazines, and it's not called clips. A clip is actually, it's like this plastic thing, and you have like a roll of bullets. It looks weird. They are magazines, not clips. Anyway, a handgun magazine now, most of them come with a minimum of a 15-shot magazine. So you think about this for a minute. Now, if you have, you know, two handguns, okay, two 9mm, two, and if you want more powerful, say you even have two 40 caliber or 45s, which you could get. Now, the 45 bullets are bigger, but you definitely can get a 40-round magazine in a Glock. There are Glocks that are standard 40 caliber Glocks that come with 17-round magazines. So if you had two Glocks, 17-round magazines, then had a belt or a bag or whatever with a bunch of magazines that were all 17-round, what is the difference between that and an AR-15? And again, we're not even, we'll get into all the other stuff as well. But, of course, what happens anytime there's a shooting, never mind what the reason was, whether this is a terrorist attack, whether it's an anti-gay attack. First of all, this is the perfect, I think, incident for politicians to exploit, because it contains everything they need. You got the gun part, so they can go use it to go after guns. You got the anti-gay part, so you can use it to go after discrimination and that gay people are attacked all the time. And don't get me wrong, I know gay people are, it can be hard for gay people at times, but gay people are rarely murdered. And definitely not something like this, obviously. And you know, I believe in freedom for everybody. I believe in respect for everybody. I have no problem with anybody being gay. And, of course, you know, I feel bad for all the families and everybody that was injured there. And of course, the people that died, although I look at it as the people that died don't know that they died. So I feel bad that they won't get to experience the rest of their lives. But saying it in a way that, you know, they I don't know, I'm kind of as far as how I kind of tripping up my words there on what I mean, but I'm not saying I don't feel bad for them, but what I'm saying is, yes, of course, I feel bad that they won't get to live out the rest of their lives, but I'm more saying I feel bad for their families. I don't feel bad. I feel bad for them, but not in the same way, because they obviously can't hear me, nor will, you know, I believe that when you're dead, you're dead. So that's what I kind of mean by that. Sorry about the explanation for that, but I didn't want to say it in a way that was disrespectful. So, of course, I feel bad for the families. The people that actually died, I feel bad that they won't be able to experience the rest of their lives. But as far as saying I feel bad for them, I do, but they don't know that, because I believe that they're, you know, when you die, you die. So, but what I was saying, talking about the guns, we didn't even get into any of the, I haven't even gotten into any of that yet, but this is basically a dream for a politician to exploit, you know, for a liberal, progressive politician to exploit, because you have that part of it. And then, of course, you have the lone wolf terrorism part of it, which allows you, and this is for both parties, actually, which allows for more surveillance, more spying, more this, more that, even though all this shit hasn't worked. But the fact that it was a lone wolf, and they call it lone wolf. I actually read a book called Lone Wolf Terrorism by a guy affiliated with the, I forget the name of the institute, but it's an institute connected to the government. And it was a total propaganda book. It was bullshit. Their whole idea was to drum up the fear of lone wolf terrorism and how they have to do all these things to catch them. That basically you have to have no freedom because possibly anybody could be a terrorist. And that's what this, they can use this for that as well. So we'll get to all those, but back to the gun. So anyway, you could have two Glock 40s. They're not actually named Glock 40. Glock has numbers on their guns, but the number is not necessarily, because they have so many models. They have the model number and then the caliber. But anyway, there's Glock 40s that are 17 round standard, meaning comes with the gun, along with, I think, 10 round magazines as well. But you could buy a bunch of 17 round magazines. So right there, you got two hands, you got 34 rounds right there with two handguns, which is much easier to maneuver if you think about it. And if you're in a small space like that where you're not going to miss. And I saw an outside of the club and it looked pretty big. So the point being that you can, and this is what their goal is. Their goal, they could say whatever they want. Their goal is to totally ban guns. I don't give a fuck what they say. That's their goal, because you could do, they can say whatever they want, but you can do the same damage with handguns. You possibly can do more damage depending on the situation you're in, because of the fact it, like a long gun is going to go, it's going to travel further. But most of these shootings, they're not trying to do long range fucking shooting. And it probably will fire faster. I've never sat there and seen which I could fire faster, but the handgun's prior. If you have two in your hand, you know, it doesn't matter. Go back and you could fire them fast enough to do this enough damage where you could do the same damage. And if you have an AR-15, it's not that easy to fire it with one hand. I guess if you have a, you know, one of those straps where you have it, you know, strapped over your shoulder, like a shoulder strap, or there's a name for those things. But if you have one of those, possibly you could fire it and then fire another gun as well. But you're going to be off balance and it's going to be a lot harder. So it would be a lot easier if you were to have two handguns. If you're in a situation where, you know, you're shooting people from, you know, 10 to 15 feet away. And you could have no problem doing the same amount of damage. So, and in most of these, unless you're like the guy from the University of Texas who was on like a clock tower in a sniper-like role, that I would say it would make a difference. You're not going to snipe people at, you know, 50, 100 feet away with a handgun. I don't know how far, you know, the bullets will go, but most of the killings we're talking about and the concerns that people are talking about are more, you know, at most maybe 20 feet away, 25 feet away, and that from a handgun is no problem. So banning these guns is not going to do anything. Nothing at all. I mean, I bought, and this is just because I happen to have it, and it was like $15. I have an old 9mm Ruger, and I bought a 40 shot. It doesn't even work that well, to be honest, because I brought it to the range, and it doesn't work that well. So I was going to say I don't really use it, but I mean, I don't like have that gun for protection with that magazine in it or anything, and I wouldn't. But to go to the range, you know, you can fill it up with 40 bullets and, you know, it makes it easier. You don't have to refill your magazine. But it was a 40 round magazine. Now, most handguns aren't meant to shoot that many bullets that fast because they'll, you know, overheat or whatever, but they're fine with, and they're making them this way, like I said, for the, to be able to fire, you know, at least 17, I think it's 17 and one in the chamber. So that's 18. So that's even more. So take away the AR-15, take away the AK-47, take away any of those guns that look scary to you, and it doesn't fucking matter. It doesn't. You can still do the same damage with handguns. So that whole argument and turning this into a gun issue when France and Belgium, who killed a little more. I think France was 89 people. I don't know how many Belgium was, or it might have been the other way around. They had like four shooters. This one shooter thing does not make sense. Not only that, is the fucking story doesn't make any sense. And then you always seem to have somebody in one of these situations that was questioned by the FBI, that was put on their list, and then somehow they lost them. And that alone, you know, plus this guy worked for the DHS, man. He was security for a private security company that contracted with the DHS. So, I mean, that might not mean anything. And I'm not necessarily saying this is some false flag event, although it greatly benefits the government. And we will go through why in detail. I mentioned in summary why, but we'll go through why in more detail it benefits the government. But it definitely benefits the government, no doubt. But this is what makes no sense to me, first of all. Now, first, you have, I think, 49 people. It went back between 48 and 50 people killed. And don't get me wrong, that's a lot of people. But 2.5 million, and that's around, you know, the number, die a year. 500,000 people die of cancer and heart attacks. It's around the same. One in two is always cancer and heart attacks. Divide that by 365 days. And I'm not trying to make the death toll or make this any, you know, say that this is meaningless or anything like that, or to, what's the word I'm looking for, that these people's lives aren't important. Of course they are. But at the same time, over Memorial Day weekend, what, 69 people got killed in Chicago? You know, it all depends on who you are and how you get killed. And there's plenty of people that die that it's totally tragic as well. If somebody dies in a car accident, that's a tragic death. That's not a, you know, you could say, well, if somebody's, you know, a gangbanger or something like that and they die, is that a tragic death? I wouldn't call it tragic. Or if somebody's engaging in things that may cause their death, as opposed to just going to a club, you know, where you're a totally innocent person just going out. But there's plenty of that goes on. And, of course, they don't get the recognition. What they were doing on CNN on Fox, because they want to keep this story out there and keep it going because that's what they're being told to do. They're talking to relatives of the victims now. You know, anything to keep the story going. And how many people that died in a car accident today or yesterday or the day before? And who talked to their relatives and who even knows they're dead? What about the fucking people that were killed by police that were unarmed that you don't even fucking hear about? What about those people? What about that girl that I always bring up because it was one of the most tragic incidences when it comes to police? So it's stuck in my head. And I'm sure there's other ones that I might not even know about that were just as tragic. Samantha Ramsey, who the cop jumped on her fucking car, shot her point blank right through her windshield 4 times. 19-year-old, I think, preschool teacher. And what was her crime? Well, she went to a party, too. It wasn't at a club. It was, you know, woods party during the summer like kids do. I've been to a bunch of them when I was a kid. Now, again, I'm not trying to take anything away from these kids, but most people don't even know who she is or what even happened. That wasn't fucking on CNN or Fox or any of those. But this gets, you know, so far 3 days worth of coverage. because that's what the powers that be want, because they're going to exploit it for all they can. And hopefully they're not going to be able to. But I think when it comes to people are just too fucking pussies, because the one place they're going to get them and people are going to fall right into it is they're going to say, government, protect me from ISIS. Protect us from these people. When it comes to guns, we've been through that, and hopefully we'll continue to be able to push forward. And because common sense tells you this is a situation that says, hey, we need guns. We need more guns. If you look at it, if they're going to tell you it's dangerous, damn, there's these lone wolf terrorists. Hey, then if there's lone wolf terrorists and it's really dangerous, then shouldn't more people have guns? So, I mean, I don't know how far they're going to get with that, if they're going to get anywhere. Let me get back to what happened as far as how I understand it, which I really don't. And I read all these articles, watched some of the government bullshit media via YouTube, or at least listened to it, and I'm still not understanding what went on here. So supposedly he came there, went in. At some point, he exchanged gunfire with police, or with an officer that was, I guess, at the door. And then went back in. Now, this is where it doesn't make any sense. Okay, so he went back in. The officer did what, first of all? Just stood outside and called other officers? And if he did... Now, in hostage situations where you're talking to the person and you're actually negotiating not to kill them, I understand that. But they didn't say anything about that. It sounds like he was still killing people, as I heard one witness say, that he didn't kill her, but he killed somebody else that was lying on the floor. So usually if there's a situation where you have somebody that is not holding hostages, that is there killing people, actually from the get-go, I mean, this was not a, I'm robbing this place and I'm holding hostages and I'm trying to get out of here. This was... I'm trying to kill people. So I don't get why there was a 3-hour standoff period. That makes no sense to me. And what had happened from the beginning makes no sense to me. How, so if you want to say 49 people killed and 53 injured, comes out to what, 102 bullets minimum. Right. And that doesn't count all the people that were shot multiple times, and witnesses had said that. So you got to say, what about all the misses? Unless, again, this guy is a fucking trained military assassin. He's going to miss a lot. Where it seems like he didn't even have a gun before. Who knows if he ever even fucking shot one? Well, not true. He did have a permit to carry a handgun because it through a security job. But that doesn't mean, you know, he was at the range every fucking week. And an AR-15 is not a handgun. It's very different in how you shoot. So, that being said, that's at least 200 rounds. Now, AR-15s, they make 30-round magazines for them. I don't know anything about the handgun. Standard handguns have like 10, but like I was saying, that a lot of them now have at least, you know, maybe 15, but I don't know how many magazines. I don't know if he fired his handgun. They didn't go into any of that. And this is where I'm always skeptical. When a story comes out in bits and pieces, and of course, one, I don't believe the fucking government media. They're not asking questions that they should be asking. And at the same time, the police are making up their story as they go. They're talking to witnesses and then trying to build it around that. But then, you know, witnesses can get things wrong, obviously, not even on purpose, just if you're in a situation like that, panicking and not realizing or remembering correctly what happened. But I still don't know what the fuck happened. And like I said, I went through a bunch of shit as far as articles and reports, and I still don't know what happened. So one of the theories that I had brought up, and the guy that was on Stefan Molyneux's show had brought up as well, is he was exchanging gunfire with the police. Did the police end up killing anybody? And I would say that I don't know that they're going to do autopsies and ballistics checks. I would doubt it, because I would guarantee you that they'd be pulling rounds that whatever the, and I think the police actually use 40 caliber Glocks. They'd be pulling those out of a lot of the bodies. I would guarantee you. And there was one point where they had said that there was 100 hostages. How could one person take 100? Wouldn't you just all run it? 10 people could probably take the guy. I know he got a gun, but I'd rather take my chances fucking trying to get this guy down. I don't know his measurements, but he didn't seem to be a big guy. Of course, he had to reload at times. It doesn't make a lot of sense at all. So I believe that at some point they're going to come up with some fucking story. But to do what he did, again, you'd have to be some trained fucking assassin, in my opinion. And maybe he was, and maybe he fucking worked for the CIA, and this was a whole, you know, false flag CIA operation. I'm not saying that I think that, but anything's possible. And the reason why I always bring up the fact that anything's possible and to always ask those questions, and why I understand why people come to that conclusion a lot of the time, because look how it benefits the government. So it's like, why wouldn't they do something like that? And, you know, all the shit that politicians do and how they believe they're untouchable, but they wouldn't pull something like this off. And not even necessarily a politician, but they hint at it, or they create an environment. This is better for them, because then they're not part of an actual conspiracy, but creating an environment where something like this is bound to happen. And that's always the best option for politicians is if they, it's just like 9/11, before 9/11, and this is a fact, all of the DHS and Patriot Act and all of that stuff was already written. They were just waiting for something that they could exploit to use to pass all of this stuff. So that's what they do, is as politicians, they exploit what they can to push their agendas. That's another thing you can't argue with. Now, you can argue with whether or not certain things were false flags, or if the majority of politicians or powers that be get involved, or the CIA get involved in false flags. Although I think it's hard to argue that the CIA doesn't, when it comes to things overseas, that it's hard to argue that the CIA doesn't get involved, because obviously I think there's enough information that says that they do, and they have been since they've been created. But, and I believe that the U.S. runs ISIS anyway. So I don't necessarily think that this had anything, you know, they're saying that this is a lone wolf. This was not an ISIS ordered attack. And, you know, it's all about perception. It's how they make you perceive it as, do you perceive it as a hate crime? Do you perceive it? Obviously, if what they say happened really happened, which, again, I still don't even know what happened, but that this guy killed 50 people or 49 people and injured 53, if that is what really happened. Now, the other thing could be that there were other shooters that people didn't see and somehow they got out. That's possible too. But you would think that that would come out. But usually when the FBI fucks up, they don't fuck up. It's for a reason. So you could also look at the whole thing that they let this happen, and maybe they even helped in it happening. So I would say that in the sense of, okay, they had nothing to do with this guy. It wasn't a setup like that. They knew that this was going to happen. They also placed possible shooters there as well, who contributed to what happened. And I know this is going to be hard for people to believe. Then you also have the shootout with police. I think there's no doubt that they killed some people by accident in that as well. And then they knew that, you know, everything that was going, well, I had already said they knew that he was going to do this, and when he bought the guns and all of that. And they let it happen because they wanted it to happen for obvious reasons. So that could be a possibility as well. But there's no disputing the fact that this benefits certain people within the government, not just the politicians themselves, but the FBI, the NSA, the CIA, although the CIA is not supposed to operate on U.S. soil. I don't know that many people know that. I mentioned it on the show before. I didn't know that. And a lot of people might not know that the CIA was developed after World War II. There's a movie on it with Matt Damon and Robert De Niro, but it wasn't supposed to be a permanent thing. It was World War II, and then I think for the Russians as well and the Cold War. But it wasn't supposed to last forever. But we know that any organization that's developed by the government, it never goes anywhere. So once they created it, it's there. But it was not supposed to be a permanent organization. And of course, look, you want to talk about organizations that have done damage to the country or to people in general. I don't know that there's another organization that you can say has done the amount of damage that the CIA has done. That's because they're able to run amok, essentially. That they're an organization that does whatever the fuck they want to do. And the U.S. is developing more organizations like that. And what I mean is they're not developing like they're out there developing new organizations. I mean that these current organizations are developing into untouchable organizations like the NSA. They can't touch the NSA because the NSA has so much information on everybody. And it's going to come to a point where they won't be able to do anything against the NSA, period, because they'll have the records of everybody from birth. I mean, they're close to that now, but they won't be able to ever touch them because they'll just blackmail them. There's nobody who has, I mean, I was thinking about this, you know, if there's anything that really I would be embarrassed that if I came out and told people, and you know, to be honest, at least what I remember, blackouts and I'm drunk or something. But no, I mean, not embarrassed, but you know, of course, you could say there's things that you wouldn't want, like your employer to know, but it's nothing that bad. But still, if you're a politician and it comes out, oh, when you were younger, you did this or did that, and nothing that bad, but bad enough to make people not vote for you, then, you know, it gives them a lot of power and a lot of control over things. So anyway, we're going to take a break. When we get back, we'll talk more about the effects that this may have and the exploitation that I'm sure will take place by politicians and how they may use this to not only take away more freedom, but other things as well. So, on Mondays, we have a new show, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, the Illumination Hour with host Ellen Stallone. And that comes on every Monday, so be sure to listen to that. You can also find the archives on Spreaker and SoundCloud and YouTube as well. But if you want to listen live, it's actually pre-recorded, so live on tape, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, every Monday night is a new episode, and she's doing some great things. I would call it, I think the word different doesn't give it justice because it's unique. It's definitely a unique show. There's been two episodes so far, so I hope she continues to do the show. And so far, two really good episodes. So if you've missed them, go to Spreaker and pick those up and or sign up for the RSS feed and get them delivered to you automatically. Also, if you'd like to donate, we do have donation pages on nonpartisanlibertyforall.com along with new articles. I am working on a, I don't know how many part series because there's going to be a lot of parts to it on the war on drugs and why they should be legal like they were before 1914. And the newest part in the series, hopefully I might even be able to release it tonight, but I might not have enough time. So if not, most likely by tomorrow or the weekend, the newest part of the series. So far there are three parts, and you can read those at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. So we will be back right after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
911 calls from the club during the attack at about 2:30 in the morning. He made 911 calls from the club during the attack at about 2:30 in the morning, Sunday morning. And there were three different calls. During the calls, he said he was doing this for the leader of ISIL, who he named and pledged loyalty to. But he also appeared to claim solidarity with the perpetrators of the Boston Marathon bombing and solidarity with a Florida man who died as a suicide bomber in Syria for Al-Nusra Front, a group in conflict with the so-called Islamic State. But we are highly confident that this killer was radicalized and at least in some part through the internet.
The FBI director today talking about the investigation into Omar Mateen, the 29-year-old terrorist at the center of all of this. And just in the past few minutes, Peter Ducey talking to a survivor shot four times at that nightclub, saying from his hiding place in the bathroom with 30 others, he could hear the terrorist laughing, describing it as a last laugh of satisfaction, like I'm getting done what I came here to do. With that, let's bring in our panel. Steve Hayes, senior writer for the Weekly Standard. Charles Hurt, political columnist for the Washington Times. Ron Fournier, senior political columnist in the National Journal. And syndicated columnist Charles Krauthammer. Steve, your thoughts on the whole thing, and then specifically on the investigation that the FBI director talked about.
Well, the thing that struck me most today was listening to the 14-minute statement that the president delivered after his briefing. You know, what he said today I thought was better than what he had said in the past, if only because he acknowledged that this obvious terrorist attack was a terrorist attack. But that's really damning with faint praise. I think if you think about some of the other things that the president said, they were at least in tension with one another, if not outright contradictory. He said, for instance, that we didn't know the motivation of the attacker. He said, I think we don't yet know the motivation. He said this today, 36 hours after we learned that at least eyewitnesses said he shouted Allahu Akbar as he carried out the attack. As you heard Director Comey say, he pledged loyalty to Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. We know that he had long contact with jihadists in the past. We know
he mentioned the Tsarnaev brothers and the 9/11.
The Tsarnaev brothers. We know that he had told people that he wanted to emulate al-Qaeda. We know that he claimed in 2014 in interviews with the FBI that he wanted to be martyred. How in the world is there any question about what his motivations are? It beggars the imagination that the President of the United States could say on national television, even as he allowed that this person did pledge loyalty to ISIS, beggars the imagination that he could say we don't know the motivations. But the second point, real quickly, is that he also said in this same 14-minute statement that we think it was a homegrown attack, that he doesn't have any associations with outside terrorists. Again, how in the world would you know that after 36 hours? I certainly wouldn't point to the FBI investigation as thorough.
Charlie?
Yeah, you know, and the point where he said that there's no clear evidence that this is part of a larger plot. Hello. I mean, all of these things are part of a larger plot. And then for him to actually pivot and within such a short period of time, turn it into some way to advance this the partisan political agenda about gun control, where this, I mean, this doesn't have anything to do with that. This is a national security thing.
But It is powerful when they make the point that this guy had been investigated twice by the FBI and yet still didn't send any red flags up, is it not?
He's still got a gun.
Yeah, but he got the guns, he wouldn't have gotten the guns if they had perhaps investigated further, done whatever it took. You know, and it's like this whole argument about the people on the no-fly list, you know, making sure it's a canard. They're just bringing that up because, you know, the problem there is that they're not doing the investigations fully enough, because if they did, then those people would be on lists and not be able to get guns.
To hear the FBI director, Ron, it's like a needle in the haystack, and they have thousands of needles.
Yeah, and we're having a hard time figuring out when the straws turn into a needle. I mean, it is an awfully imprecise, imperfect thing the FBI has to do. They're not going to be able to get all of the bad guys. That's just a fact of the matter. At some point, we had to realize that this is a little bit harder than we want to make it believe. We try to oversimplify these things. For example, what are the underlying issues in here? Yes, one of them is Islamic extremism. Also, gun control is an underlying issue here. What do we have to do to get the guns out of some of these people's hands? Mental health is an issue here. It's not just one of these things. Our leaders are kind of giving us false choices. On the president, you're right, he's very tone deaf on these issues, but he did call out today, we have to counter extremism. Now, he didn't say Islamic extremism, but we know what he's talking about. And on the other side, we have Donald Trump, who his first reaction to this, or actually his third tweet, was to give himself a pat on the back. And then he suggested that the president of the United States is somehow involved in the Orlando terrorism. Now, that's no matter what you think of the president, you don't think he's actually involved in terrorism. And then he ends the day by taking on the Washington Post.
On the morning show, he said either he is completely unable to do his job or unqualified, or there's something else.
He said there's something going on here. Right. Now, what is he talking about?
I understand what you're saying. We're going to talk about politics in a second. Charles.
Look, I think there's one thing here that is that the president refuses to understand, and I think it's because of the failure of his policy. The way to defeat and to prevent these things is not gun control. And it is not the FBI investigating. Yes, to some extent that will mitigate it. But in a country of this size, with so many people as potential targets of investigation, unless you want to create a police state, there is no way that you can prevent. There's only one way to go after this. And that is the Osama bin Laden theory. And he knew about jihadism, of the strong horse and the weak horse. I think Brit Hume had it right. Ultimately, the only way to decrease recruitment is not with logic, not with argument, not with really clever programmers who know how to do Twitter. It is by defeating the jihadists or showing them in retreat. These movements only grow when they have a sense of inevitability and growth. Once they are in retreat, people stop recruiting. You're not going to die in a suicide attack for a movement that is not advancing. And that means attacking ISIS where it is.
Here is the father, Siddiqui Mateen, and he has previously expressed a loyalty to the Taliban in Afghanistan. He said some interesting things. This is the father on Facebook.
The issue of homosexuality and punishment belongs to God. It does not belong to a servant of Allah, but I am really saddened that he has committed this action.
The longer part of video, the interesting thing was, as even this far into this, that there were people making this case that this was more about a hate crime against homosexuals, and because this guy had expressed problems with that. But the linkage between radical Islam, they want to erase homosexuality, and they throw people from buildings, homosexuals from buildings. Radical Islamists do.
Sure. So not only radical Islamists, I mean, you look at certain states in the region. Homosexual acts are punished by death, literally punished by death. So, yeah, Britt pointed that out in his commentary. I think there's a huge double standard. You saw this in the email that Hillary Clinton's campaign sent out this afternoon, where she emphasized again and again and again the LGBT issues. She talked about the need to warn off Islamophobia, but didn't talk about the ideology in any detail that motivates.
But yesterday it happened in a vacuum. We also had a guy who was caught with a whole bunch of killing weapons that was heading towards in L.A. I mean, this isn't just in a vacuum. There obviously is a homophobia problem out there internationally and in the United States. There's nothing wrong with pointing that out.
Nothing wrong with pointing it out. You can't pick and choose what your issues are. I mean, you read these letters from Hillary Clinton and from the president, from Organizing for America. They're picking and choosing these issues. They're choosing not to talk about
radicalism. Or at least focusing more heavily on one than the other.
Today, as Americans, we grieve the brutal murder, a horrific massacre of dozens of innocent people. We pray for their families who are grasping for answers with broken hearts. We stand with the people of Orlando who have endured a terrible attack on their city. Although it's still early in the investigation, we know enough to say that this was an act of terror and an act of hate. And as Americans, we are united in grief, in outrage, and in resolve to defend our people. I just finished a meeting with FBI Director Comey and my Homeland Security and National Security advisors. The FBI is on the scene and leading the investigation in partnership with local law enforcement. I've directed that the full resources of the federal government be made available for this investigation. We are still learning all the facts. This is an open investigation. We've reached no definitive judgment on the precise motivations of the killer. The FBI is appropriately investigating this as an act of terrorism, and I've directed that we must spare no effort to determine what, if any, inspiration or association this killer may have had with terrorist groups. What is clear is that he was a person filled with hatred. Over the coming days, we will uncover why and how this happened, and we will go wherever the facts lead us. This morning, I spoke with my good friend Orlando Mayor Buddy Dyer, and I conveyed to him the deepest condolences of the American people. This could have been any one of our communities. So I told Mayor Dyer that whatever help he and the people of Orlando need, they are going to get it. As a country, we will be there for the people of Orlando today, tomorrow, and for all the days to come. We also express our profound gratitude to all the police and first responders who rushed to harm's way. Their courage and professionalism saved lives and kept the carnage from being even worse. It's the kind of sacrifice that our law enforcement professionals make every single day for all of us, and we can never thank them enough. This is an especially heartbreaking day for all of our friends, our fellow Americans who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender. The shooter targeted a nightclub where people came together to be with friends, to dance and to sing and to live. The place where they were attacked is more than a nightclub. It is a place of solidarity and empowerment where people have come together to raise awareness, to speak their minds, and to advocate for their civil rights. So this is a sobering reminder that attacks on any American, regardless of race, ethnicity, religion, or sexual orientation, is an attack on all of us and on the fundamental values of equality and dignity that define us as a country. And no act of hate or terror will ever change who we are or the values that make us Americans. Today marks the most deadly shooting in American history. The shooter was apparently armed with a handgun and a powerful assault rifle. This massacre is therefore a further reminder of how easy it is for someone to get their hands on a weapon that lets them shoot people in a school or in a house of worship, or a movie theater, or in a nightclub. And we have to decide if that's the kind of country we want to be. And to actively do nothing is a decision as well. In the coming hours and days, we'll learn about the victims of this tragedy, their names, their faces, who they were.
Now, I got to say this right now, just so I don't miss it later. To say that, first of all, of course, he's going to go to guns, and we'll talk about that when we come back. But the fact that he mentions it shows how easy it is to get a gun in this country. This guy was contracting with the federal fucking government. He worked for a security company that contracted with the federal government. He got a gun that way. So to make that statement is fucking asinine, because obviously I would assume that this security company does extra background checks, you know, goes beyond like McDonald's would or something like that. And he had a permit to conceal carry, from what I understand. I could be wrong on that, because maybe he could just open carry, but I don't think you can just open carry in Florida. But I'm not sure. I could be wrong about that. But the fact that he worked for the government, essentially, or contracted with the government, did contract work, to make a statement like that is fucking asinine. It shows that he doesn't even know what the fuck he's talking about.
Were the joy that they brought to families and to friends, and the difference that they made in this world. Say a prayer for them, and say a prayer for their families. That God give them the strength to bear the unbearable. And that he give us all the strength to be there for them, and the strength and courage to change. We need to demonstrate that we are defined more as a country by the way they live their lives than by the hate of the man who took them from us. As we go together, we will draw inspiration from heroic and selfless acts. Friends who helped friends, took care of each other, and saved lives. In the face of hate and violence, we will love one another. We will not give in to fear or turn against each other. Instead, we will stand united as Americans to protect our people and defend our nation and to take action against those who threaten us. May God bless the Americans we lost this morning. May comfort their families. May God continue to watch over this country that we love. Thank you.
Promoting the ideas of true freedom and liberty, Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Again, check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. There's still time to call in, 702-470-7664 if you'd like to call in, or if you'd like to call in via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. That was just a fucking stupid-ass speech, is really all I can say about it. And the fact that he wants to bring up the gun issue when this was a guy who I mentioned essentially worked for the Department of Homeland Security. So anyway, regarding the gun issue, of course, he loves when anything like this happens, because he's been trying to go after guns since his second election. And it's kind of funny, because he had said before he got elected that he would just, you know, keep enforce the laws on the books or whatnot. And he didn't really go after them in his first term when he could have, when there was a all Democratic Congress. But as soon as he had the chance with Sandy Hook and he was reelected for the second time, goes right after guns. And then everything that's happened that's related to guns since then, he's used and exploited to go after. He exploited the fuck out of Sandy Hook, brought up little kids on stage, done whatever he could politically. It was fucking sick. Now, what is he going to do with this? He still has about 5.5 months left. So, you know, and I don't think it matters who becomes president. I believe they're going to go after guns as well, regardless of what they say. But the states are the ones right now that continue, because I think a lot of people have seen through the bullshit. Now, the other side of it, of course, is the, you know, ISIS. And a lot of people are wanting, though, things like additional background checks or things like that. Now, that's the thing where I don't think they could ban anything right now. But who knows? But something like this, where he kept bringing up, well, if you're on the terror watch list. Well, if you're on the terror watch list, that just, there's no due process there. That just means they put you on there. They could put anybody on there and say, you can't buy a gun because we put you on this watch list because we felt like it. And then they could go after people that are not Muslim. Now, first of all, also remember that neither of these attacks, if you look at this one and the one in San Bernardino, were by ISIS. First of all, they were ISIS inspired. Okay, that's like saying, you know, somebody going and shooting up a place and saying they were inspired by fucking Hitler. They were not. Both of them were born in the U.S., and both of them said they were ISIS inspired. They didn't have connections to ISIS. Now, this guy, they're now also saying there's two things. There's one, that somebody claims they had heard him call 911 and say something about he supports ISIS or something like that. So if that indeed happened, they would have a record of it, because all 911 calls are recorded, and it would have been from either his cell phone or a phone at the club. The other thing was, they were saying that there were reports that he was on gay dating sites, that even in high school, people thought he was possibly gay, and that he couldn't deal with that. And that was part of it as well. So is that what it is? Is it attack against gay people? Is it a ISIS inspired attack? They're going to use it both ways, because I guess that's kind of, no pun intended there, but because, again, it benefits the government. So first you have the gun issue. They're going to exploit that. Of course, Hillary, I believe she's mentioned it already. You've heard the speech from Obama. And they're going to do what they can to exploit the use of guns in that incident, which they've been trying to do now for a while. And that's where I think, as I've said, a lot of people aren't buying that. Now, I don't believe there should be any restrictions on guns. I don't give a fuck if you're a convicted felon. And it used to be like that as well. It's funny how all of these, it's not funny like that kind of funny, but all of these freedoms, and this is what I'm writing about when it comes to drugs as well, that at one point, drugs were like any other product, and so were guns. And at some point, because an incident happened and people, we had talked about this last week when Ken Shorten was on, how something will happen, even with drinking and driving, it wasn't like it is now. Something will happen, and then there'll be it will be somebody's family, and there'll be that one person that will start this big organization and try to fight against the government and get all these laws passed. And that's pretty much, when you look at the history, a lot of these laws, I know the one for opium, it was this, I think, pastor or preacher that went to the Philippines and saw they were growing opium over there and sent a letter to Roosevelt, the first Roosevelt, Theodore Roosevelt, and, you know, got that first law passed that where it had to state if there was a drug in a product, what it was. And then from there, in 1914, there was the Harris Act that pretty much said, you know, you got to get a prescription and pay a tax on opium. And it was downhill from there. And all of these things that if you ask somebody, oh, do you think this should be legal? They'd be like, oh my God, no. Like, they'd be in shock. But think about why. And think about how people are conditioned. Because back then, it wasn't a big deal. You say to the majority of people now, oh, do you think heroin should be legal? You'd be like, hell no. Or do you think that anybody should be able to get a gun? I mean, even people that support guns or the right to carry, you know, want background checks and want people to get concealed carry permits and all of this stuff. I don't believe in any of that. I don't. And I think short term, I think it never should have went that way, if it's especially in a country that was supposed to be free. Because obviously at that point, there was no freedom. Now, I'm one of those people who, of course, look at government as a bad thing. Government being there to eventually take all your rights away and being about money, power, and control, and all governments are and have been. And from the beginning, that they start to take your rights away. But most people don't know that history because they're not going to teach you it in school. And you have to kind of look for it on your own. And before the internet, it was really hard to even get a lot of that information. I guess you could get it in books, but who's going to think to, you know, well, let me read about the history of drugs. I guess people would, but it's a lot easier. And you had, you know, there's so many things in life, and that's why even it's hard to blame people for not knowing all these things, because they have kids. I look at it, you know, I do this show, which I can barely do. I mean, from a energy standpoint, and work full time, I try to work out and spend time with my fiance as much as I can. And that's really all I have time to do. So, and I wish I would go back to reading more books, because before the show, I was reading a lot of books, and I am getting them from the library. I just haven't read much of the books that I've gotten, but I could do that if I wasn't watching so much TV, but at least I'm watching a lot of documentaries. So that's good from that standpoint. But so I understand, but what is the big deal if somebody goes to jail? And that's a whole nother issue that is just, you know, the majority of people have never been arrested, although the percentage of people that are getting arrested is getting higher and higher. And depending on where you're arrested as well, it can be a very bad experience, and it can be getting arrested for something that's not even a serious crime. and what you have to go through and how you're treated. And, you know, this country is nothing like how they portray it at all. It's not even close. Now, maybe you're in your little fucking bubble and never had to experience any of these things, but it doesn't mean that's because, well, I just do the right thing all the time and that's why, because that is not the case. There have been so many people that have been fucked over by the system. And, but when it comes to guns, if you, so take, I'll use him as an example, because he's a good guy. Mark Edge from Free Talk Live, who I consider a friend, although he lives in New Hampshire. So, you know, when he comes to Vegas, so I'll, you know, we'll have dinner or something. But he was convicted of a felony when he was like 18 or 19. I believe he's 42 now. He spent, I think, 8 years in jail. I think he got out when he was 27. So it's been at least 15 years. He's never been arrested in that time. I don't know if he's even gotten a speeding ticket. Now, why does he have his right to protect his family taken away because of something that he did, that he had to pay for that by going to jail for that time? So shouldn't, you know, it's fine. While you're in jail, you don't get to carry a gun. I'm okay with that. But he should be able to buy a gun. I have no problem with that. Not just him, you know, anybody, because people that are felons that are going to use it in, you know, to rob a place or something like that are usually able to get it illegally anyway. And it's easier, actually, for the police if they use the traceable gun in a crime. So, but I don't believe in the fact that because you've committed a crime, your rights are gone for the rest of your life, that certain rights are gone for the rest of your life. Now, during the time maybe you're in jail, obviously, because your freedom is gone because you're in jail. So, but once you're out of jail, or say you serve probation or something like that, and after that is finished, then yeah, I believe that there should be no restrictions on guns, period. I believe that the only way to a separation of powers or balance of powers is that the people have the same weapons that the police have. Now, that aside, getting back to this, these two guys, and I believe that based off the limited information I have now, because of the interaction with the FBI, yeah, I believe that they probably knew what was going on. Now, again, I could be totally wrong and not know what the fuck I'm talking about. And, you know, I'm not an expert in FBI protocol or, you know, but it's just hard to believe with all the spying they're doing, all of this shit. I know that stuff gets compartmentalized and this agency doesn't communicate with this agency, but I just seriously doubt it. I believe they let it happen. And again, the United States has not been attacked by ISIS. They want to put that idea in your head because they want that fear. Because what does fear do? Fear, which is part of this, they want people to be in fear because then people turn to governments. The less you need the government, the worse it is for them. If you don't need them, then why would they be around? And what's the point of having a government? So, obviously, they need things like this to happen. And I believe that it's proven that they created Al-Qaeda. I mean, it's not like someone had to prove it. It's a fact that they gave money to Osama bin Laden, who was a CIA asset fighting against the Russians in the Afghan war, who took it and started Al-Qaeda. And that ISIS partially came out of that. But I think it's totally CIA funded, totally CIA run. So that's why this could potentially, it's not impossible that this incident was a guy who was just fucking nuts. But it's hard to believe with all the information they collect and that they've already talked to this guy. At the same time, you have the amount of shots that he got off, the amount of people between being killed and injured, which had to be at least 200 rounds. It had to be. And that's going to be, what, about 7 magazines off an AR-15? And then what happened between this 3 hours now? Was he sitting just shooting people? There were supposedly people locked in the bathroom. It just, there's so much that does not make sense. Also, I would assume that they had surveillance cameras because every club that I know of, every club in general, as far as I know, and places that aren't even clubs have surveillance cameras. So I don't know what they're doing right now. I would say they're putting together what their narrative is going to be. But either way, whatever the narrative is, the bottom line is, and Charles Krauthammer kind of said this, you know, unless you want to live in a police state, you know, if there is actually, and I'm sure there's some, however, I don't know that in this case, it's what happened, but random acts of terrorism or violence, you cannot, in a free society, they're going to happen. It's a fact of life. And in comparison to other countries, the population and the percentage of how many people are actually killed in events like this, it's very small. What happens is you have the media have, you know, coverage, I'm sure will continue through the rest of the week and they'll keep it out there. And people think this happens all the time. But the truth is, it does not. So if people ask, they always want to, we have to stop this. We have to, and usually they don't need something that actually stops it or is even related. Like they said, well, about Trump said he didn't want to let anybody in from the Middle East. Well, that wouldn't have stopped this guy because he was born here. And with the Sandy Hook shooting, they wanted to what they call assault rifles. Something about you have to, I remember it was something that wouldn't have done anything, like about having I know what it was, the database of, you know, crazy people or whatever, but his mother bought it, so it wouldn't have done anything. Things like that, And they had a guy on Fox News today who said, there's not a, you know, of course they ask, well, is there a balance? Because obviously the government is spying on everybody. It's like they're going through all your stuff. They might as well be in your house going through everything. Is there a balance? Is the balance okay? And of course the guy said, no, we're at war. We need, you know, civil liberties. Who gives a fuck about those, basically, is what he said, that the government needs to go further. Because, again, they need to show, oh, we're doing something about this. It's the same shit with drugs. It's the same shit no matter what it is. And the bottom line is, none of it is going to stop any of the stuff that happens. And what it's really going to do is meet their true goal, which is more power and more control over your life. And that's what it's about. That's bottom line what it is about. It's about being able to have that power over you and that control over you. Because look at how things have changed in 100 years. And in stupid shit like the drug laws, you're putting people in jail for life for having, there was a, you know, documentary I was watching, and a guy got caught at customs with, I think, something like 5 pounds of cocaine. And, you know, they said he'd probably do like 20 years in jail. I mean, it's insane. And then they try to twist it and fuck with people's minds like, oh, you're hurting people because you're bringing this in and then people are using it. And that's when I go back to stuff like SSRIs that have still, you know, who knows what is going to happen to people 20 years from now that have taken those for years and years. And that's something that pharmaceutical companies developed. But either way, I mean, look at how many things are bad for you. Fucking Pepsi. And I like Pepsi, but I'm sorry, it's not good for you. McDonald's. All of this shit. Look at what people are dying of. Cancer and heart attacks. So, and it's only a matter of time, because getting control of insurance is going to allow them to get control over things like that as well, where you get a discount if you eat this way or that way, or even worse, that you're forced to have these certain screenings. And if you don't have them, you don't get this discount and you end up paying a ridiculous amount of money. I mean, that's where it's going. And again, it's all about control. And the people that don't realize that, I don't know. Because it's obvious. The government doesn't give a fuck about you or your family or any of that shit. There may be specific people in the government somewhere, but it doesn't stop them from, you know, going along with what, who they got to go along with, making these deals and doing all this shit. So you have the gun issue. Whether anything will come out of that or not, I hope not. And I hope that will die down. And, you know, they can talk about the trying to ban what they call assault weapons, which really isn't even I hate when they use that word because it's not even a real thing. Because what it was in the bill, it was if it had three of these things or two of these things, we consider it an assault weapon. And I have heard, and this is only hearsay, so I didn't read any articles or anything like that on it, but that California is trying to get rid of grandfathering. So, for example, when they had the assault weapons ban in 1994, I believe, anything you bought before, you know, pre-ban was fine. They didn't make you turn in your guns. They just said you can't produce any new ones. You could even buy old ones still. They would sell old pre-ban guns. They just wouldn't manufacture any new ones during that time. So they did that. But from what I heard with California, the stuff that they want to ban, they do not want to grandfather anything in, meaning most likely not only can you not buy pre-bans, but you'll have to turn them in or you're illegally possessing a gun. And see, that's where another reason, obviously, why I wouldn't live in California. But that's where I draw a line. And I think that people need to start drawing their lines, seriously, where they need to stand up. And I will continue to promote noncompliance and self-defense. And I know people look at my page all the time and they don't click like, they just look at it. And maybe they don't believe what I'm saying, or maybe they just are scared to click like because they put them on a list or something. But the truth is that there is no solution that involves government. And what I mean by that is there is no route to freedom through the system, through government. It's gone. Now, whether there was, there hasn't been in a long time. So if you want to obtain some level of true freedom and liberty, there's not even a small level of true freedom and liberty you're going to obtain through government. It's not going to happen, especially not now with the terrorism. And that's one of the reasons. I think the main reason to create ISIS was to go after Syria. But at the same time, it was also for shit like this. Now, ISIS, again, has not attacked the United States, but they can use this, well, inspired by ISIS. And then some people that are ignorant are going to say, look, we've been attacked by ISIS twice already, and we're going to continue to be attacked by ISIS. And no, that's not what's happening. If somebody reads a book on somebody, or I said earlier, Hitler, or I don't know, I don't know any leaders offhand that are anti-United States. I'm sure there are. Or Kim Jong-il. If somebody attacks, shoots up a place and says, I'm doing this because of North Korea and Kim Jong-il. I was inspired by Kim Jong-il. Are you going to say North Korea attacked the United States? No. So it's bullshit. It's what the government wants people to think. And so I'll get back to that in a minute. The other thing is you have what's going on now is that they're trying, basically, the progressives, is get together every minority, and including women now, saying that every minority is being oppressed and white people, white men are evil and they're oppressing everybody. And this is another example. But it's hard to really go that route, but they can still use, well, look at, you know, somebody tried to kill a bunch of gay people. So look at what the, you know, whole thing, violence on gay people, because the reality of the amount of violence on gay people is very minimal. And the majority of people are accepting, which is a good thing. And they can use something like this to exploit that. They can pass stronger hate crime bills, which I don't believe in, because you have to somehow get into the mind of the person. Basically, if somebody beats somebody up for no reason, you charge them with assault and battery. What do you need an extra, you know, well, they did it because of this. How does that help? So I know they could say, well, we can put them in jail longer. Well, you have a pretty big window anyway, when it comes to things like that, when it comes to just random assault. So if it's a random assault, you really don't need any federal, because they're federal laws is what it is. So the federal government can get more involved in things like that. They can try to use it to get more involved in hate crimes. Not necessarily just hate crimes against gay people, but hate crimes against anybody. So that's one of the other things, along with, you know, another incident involving guns. And then, of course, you have probably the most dangerous part of this, which is the lone wolf terrorists idea, that at any time, some lone wolf that was born here, they don't even have to be Muslim, because, you know, you got the right wing terrorists as well. You got neo-Nazis or whoever. So the government needs to continue to take more and more data and spy more on people and keep even more tags on people. There is no way. I think about these other countries, because they don't even have the fucking technology that the U.S. has, that the United States is even close to the freest country in the world. Now, I don't know what country would be, because all countries are run by governments. And all governments, I believe, have the same goal. But it's harder for some governments to meet that goal. And the U.S. is, you know, if you want to talk about tyrannies, and not only a tyranny, but a tyranny in without really showing it. It's like, I've said this so many times, they are so good at oppressing people without them even realizing their oppression. It's like a fucking Jedi mind trick. And they give people just enough so they won't risk it. You know, they give them that. Plus, there's the pressure in society. Well, get married and have kids. And then once you have kids, it's like, okay, you know, you can't stand up for anything anymore because, you know, you got to bow down to the man because of your kids, even though I think it's worse to do that. But, you know, even just having a wife or a fiance, you know, same, it's not on the same level as having kids, but it's similar in a sense where, you know, well, if anything were to happen, or, you know, because I get this, like, if anything, you know, if things were to get really bad and I was to, you know, stand up, and it would always be in self-defense and non-compliance for me, because I don't believe in just, you know, I don't believe in overthrowing a government or just attacking somebody. That's just, I don't know. But even that, it's, well, you know what's going to happen. If you try to defend yourself against the government, then you're either going to get killed or go to jail. Most likely get killed. And then it's, well, if you did that, you would leave me and whatever. And so you'd leave me over, you know. But we're going to get to a point where, what is the alternative? I don't think people really realize the ramifications of what is being done right now. And this, you know, even with just the spying alone, never mind the ramping up of all government agencies with their firepower, the police with their firepower and tanks. And with things like this, they don't need reasons to ramp up. They do it anyway. But they're going to use this as another reason to say, hey, look, now we have these lone wolf fuckers. We got to keep tabs on everybody. We got to do more spying. They got fucking helicopters patrolling now. How long before they do random checks of your computers, of your houses? You don't know where they're going to go with this. And at some point, it is going to go to that point. It's just, how long is it? And where do you personally, when it comes to non-compliance, when you say, I'm not complying with this law and I'm going to defend myself over it if you attack me, at what point or where do you draw that line? And maybe you'll take anything. Maybe you'll live as a slave, essentially. There's a reason why this has been a generational slow thing and not an, you know, immediate thing, although it seems to have sped up in the past 10 years or so. I don't even know that it has actually sped up when I think about it. I think it looks like it's sped up because of the information we have now. The internet is the one thing that really kind of fucked the government to a point. And I say to a point because most people don't even care about that. All this stuff that they do and whatever. I mean, there's some people that care, but there's just not enough. there's not enough for them to do anything about it, for the government to say, wait a minute, you know, if we don't change this or change that, then, you know, we could have civil unrest, or we could have some crazy things happening. We could have people not obeying, because that's what they want: control, power, and obedience. So I guess I know where my lines are. And hopefully it will never get to that point. Although in some ways it's already gotten to that point, but it's things that you can't stop them from doing. If they were trying to come into my house and take my computer and take my information, which is really what they're doing, it's just because we don't see them doing that. They do all this shit in a way that you don't comprehend it in the way that actually that they're doing it. You look at it in a totally different way. And like I said, they make sure that people have enough, you know, to not risk things, like to sit there and say, hey, I have, you know, like I have a nice house that I rent and, you know, my job's okay. And I have things, I have equipment to do a radio show. I have, you know, DirecTV. I don't know, a lot of possessions, I guess. I have a car. So, yeah, they have been the best at doing it in a way that people are like, well, why am I going to risk this? And what's going to happen is, by the time that they realize, it's going to be too late, if it's not too late already. And I think really it may be, I know you got all these people talking about, you know, Trump, and Trump is going to like, that's why now Alex Jones, I don't look at him the same way. You know, sitting there supporting Trump, like Trump is the savior, you know, against the globalist, he's going to save us. And yeah, I don't think so. And even if there was somebody like that, they'd either be killed, or their family would be threatened to be killed, or it's the people that are in office are not the people that are running things. For the most part, you know, they get all these perks and benefits, and with things that are really don't matter, you know, they are, when it comes to things that are irrelevant. But when it comes down to the things that have to do with control and the spying and the, you know, whatever they're going to do as a result of this. And I'm sure we won't hear about what they're doing, but they're going to do something. They're probably writing up a bill right now, or they already have one, or this is to, you know, hey, we need to keep the Patriot Act and maybe add to it because we got these lone wolf terrorists. But again, the fact is that I know people don't want to face this reality, but if you want to live freely, the reality is yes, things like that can happen. They don't happen often. the odds are very slim that you'll ever be involved in a something like that. But yeah, it can happen. Plus, you're talking about a country of over 300 million. You know, even if 1%, and I was saying this last week, if 1% are lunatics, that's 3 million people. Now, even though 99% of the country you ain't got to worry about, but you got 300 million, not 300 million, 3 million lunatics. Which is another reason why you should never have a country that is that big. And you should never have a country that is ruled by, you have that many people ruled by 535, if you count the president, 536 people, technically, if you want to say that those are the rulers. But that's all we have for tonight. I'd like to thank everybody for tuning in. We'll be back tomorrow. Again, be sure to tune in every Monday for Ellen Stallone's new show. Of course, former co-host of Free Talk Live and former co-host of Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Every Monday at 7 p.m. And, of course, I'm on Tuesday through Thursday, 7 p.m. And Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern. And we will be back tomorrow. Thanks, everybody. Oh, and you can get all the archives at Spreaker, among other places. And check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Thanks again.
Is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous.